Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this talk. We have been organizing a number of activities every month under our Sustainably Smart Pune study project, and under that, this is a new format that we are starting, where we will be inviting various experts to talk on sustainability, climate change, conservation related issues. There will be ample time for discussion also. That's the way we have arranged this. I hand over to Purnima now to introduce today's speaker, and then we can directly move into the talk. Over to you, Purnima.
Thank you, Dr. Karve. So good evening, everyone. I am Purnima Agarkar, and I am associated with Samuchit Envirotech, Alaya Resource Center, and the Indian Network on Ethics and Climate Change. So today, let's talk, as Dr. Karve mentioned, it's a new web series under the Sustainably Smart Pune project, which is headed by her, and I'm working on the same. And here in this series, we are going to invite eminent speakers to talk on important issues and link them to sustainability and climate change. So today we have Dr. Eraj Barucha. He's a surgeon by profession. However, his passion towards nature and wildlife led him to start an environment department at Bharati Vidyapeeth. So, and he's also an author of the textbook on environment studies for undergraduate courses. So it's a pleasure to have you here, Doc. A warm welcome to you and everyone. So I hand over to you, Dr. Barucha.
Good evening, and thank you very much for having me here, especially because you asked me to chat about one of my very favorite topics, and also because you asked me to talk about Salim Ali, who was my mentor from my very childhood. I used to go around on his motorbike. So today, talking about nature conservation in India makes me feel extremely nostalgic in some ways. And it hasn't happened on its own, you know. It has taken huge efforts of a large number of people to make conservation happen in our country. And so we have a certain historical perspective to look at. So in my first seven PPTs I'm going to show you, I'm going to give you a snapshot, an overview of what actually has happened from very ancient times. And don't go into certain specifics of how nature conservation came from botany, from zoology, and much later into conservation, and then how it got support from research, how it got support from creating protected areas and national parks and sanctuaries, and so on. So to begin with, conservation is not new in our country. It's a very ancient ethic. It is there from a Vedic period and perhaps even earlier. So at least 64,000 years ago, when people first came into the subcontinent of India from Africa, we find drawings of Bibetka on the walls of their caves. But that is really prehistory. When you come down to the history of conservation, next slide, please, Purim. The early milestones that we had were traditional and religious concepts that we had. And perhaps one of the big names in this would be Emperor Ashoka. And Ashoka, in 273, between 273 and 232 BC, he created an edict for protecting royal game and from banning hunting for his own dinner, lunch, dinner table. And this was probably a result of him turning Buddhist. So Buddha and later Mahavir had huge influence on conservation. And they knew exactly what conservation meant, especially in terms of wildlife and animals and so on. Much later, if we jump many, many steps, we come to the early British period. And they came here with the Portuguese, of course, also, for trade in spices. That's what we always believe about, that they came for spices. But they did many other things in terms of what they wanted from here. And one of them, which is hardly ever recorded, was they wanted flowering plants, right? Flowering plants from exotic areas from different parts of the world, if you had them in your empire's gardens, it meant you had a huge sense of power over the rest of the world. And at that time, the most luxurious people was the Austrian Empire, which had a huge collection of botanical specimens. And the British, of course, wanted to compete with this, and therefore they got their people to collect plants for their floral conditions and take them back to Kew Gardens. This was a very early part of how it led into not just the trade of spices, but for trade of other plants. They also needed teak. They needed teak because they wanted to build a huge navy and a very big mercantile empire. And the British did not know anything about forestry. They finished off their oak forests long, long ago. And now they wanted to use our teak for building their navy. So they also looked at it as their personal gain. We come to the Mughal period, 1500s, 1600s. And you find incredible documentation of nature in Mughal paintings, in the way they had menageries of animals. Jahangir was perhaps the greatest naturalist of India of that period. And he, of course, was a huge shikari, and they used to corral animals in hundreds and just shoot them down from elephant back. So there was this, however, feeling of wanting to know more about Indian plants and Indian animals. And that was because they came from outside and they had never seen this tremendous diversity of life of our country. We then come to the 1600s. And this is the period where the East India Company was established. And the East India Company sent doctors actually to India to treat their patients. But what happened was that they also wanted the collection of plants. And therefore, they told them, you will also botanize. And therefore, they learned a lot about our plants very early and explored a huge part of this country, even in the 1600s, 1700s, to understand the wealth of biodiversity that we had, especially of plants. But they were also great shikaris. Like the Mughals, they were also hunters. And the British bureaucrats were really fond of hunting. They brought this from England and they introduced it here. And our Maharajas and Rajas also followed suit, and they had huge hunting establishments. But one thing which had been done very, very early was that India had already set up a sort of national park-like phenomena, which they referred to as elephant reserves, because they wanted elephants for wars. It was their war machine. And the Mughals had huge number of elephants for their wars. And the elephants were trained actually to fight in a war. But look at the lower image that you see is very special today, and very special to me actually personally. It is the edict that Shivaji Maharaj wrote about protecting trees in India. This was a very far-sighted thing. And he writes that a ruler that permits trees to be cut, especially without permission of the owner of the tree, is really considered a very terrible ruler. This is his edict, this is his thinking, and this is what he told his people, that you cannot cut the trees. They are like your own children, he says. This is what happened as very early milestones. We can realize that we were far ahead in terms of conservation than certainly other countries across the world. Right, can we go next, please? So looking at a little further of these early milestones, we come to around the 1800s, where royal game and shikari sportsmen who killed large numbers of animals, like you see here, there's a tiger being shot with this huge number of elephants chasing it. They started realizing that the shikar specimens that they wanted were being depleted. And so gradually, they started to think of protecting animals that they wanted to shoot to a certain, well, today we would call it sustainable level. By 1806, we find that there was a lot of deforestation in India. And so the British government set up a committee to sort of zone forests into reserved and protected forests. This was primarily done by a person called Dietrich Brandis, who set up the first forestry department in India. Now, this is again a very interesting story. Dietrich Brandis was not British. Dietrich Brandis was German. And since the British did not know how to do formal forestry, they brought a German, he was botanist and forester, to set up a British forestry department for their imperial use. Now, this is very clear. They created this reserve forest so that only they could exploit it, and the protected forests were just left to deteriorate. So we have two now already conservation-related activities very separate from each other happening. In terms of wildlife conservation, and I found this very interesting. Look at this small other image on your left. This is the first bird sanctuary that was ever officially protected in India. It's called Vedan Thangal. And even today, it has got a huge number of pelicans, storks, ducks. It's incredibly rich in bird species. But interestingly, the first sanctuary in India, official sanctuary in India, was a bird sanctuary. So this is what was done. Let's come a little later. How was this to be legalized, all this? And therefore, in 1908 to be precise, we already had a Wild Birds Protection Act of 1887, which was not sufficient to also protect animals and habitats. And therefore, in 1908, the government, the British government, referred this matter to a person called Millard. Millard was the first joint secretary of the Bombay Natural History Society. So you can imagine that even in this early period, a very important part of what was happening for conservation in India was linked to one NGO, one society. So we now come to the period of how are they to protect forests? And so in 1927, they wrote up an Indian Forest Act. Again, the Indian Forest Act was so that the British could exploit our forests, but we could not use our own resources. And this is a very important thing to realize. Everything that happened till 1947 was to benefit England, was to benefit the British. Around 1930s, about nearly half of India was in the hands of various Maharajas and small rulers and Rajas and Samindas. And they also wanted to show their dominance in terms of prestige value. So just like they had a so many gun salute, they also said, I have a sanctuary where there are likely to be so many tigers or so many leopards or that it has gore or whatever it is. And therefore, they set up their own small, what we could now call as nature reserves. And therefore, there also, the aim was that this was shikar for themselves and avoiding the local people from taking any of the usufruct from those areas. So, come to 1937, we have a provincial conference on preservation of wildlife, which again is a BNHS initiative. It's not a government initiative. And we are now coming into a period where India was asking for independence. And there was now an early feeling that we have to do something about this, otherwise all our wildlife is going to disappear. I think, I really believe very strongly that the BNHS initiated this. You know, the BNHS was started by non-professionals. They were not botanists, they were not foresters, they were not zoologists. They were professions of all sorts from Bombay who thought that it was good to preserve wildlife. And so they set up a society. Seven guys got together and said, we will make a society that will prevent further exploitation of wildlife. And therefore, in one of their, it's somewhere near Viti. There used to be an old building which belonged to Phipson, and they set up this BNHS there. The picture, next please. Next please. Yeah. The top picture shows you what they collected. So thousands of animals were being shot. you look at this picture, up there are sheep and goats from the wild Himalayan region, and some other specimens and so on, as a private collection which was handed over to the BNHS. So this was a non-government initiative by the BNHS. But very early, around 1930s, one person stands out very, very strongly. He was a bird watcher. He says in his book called Fall of a Sparrow that the first time as a schoolboy I shot a sparrow, I found that it had a yellow patch on its neck. And so he was asked by his uncle, go to this place called BNHS and ask them that how is this sparrow different? And he went to Phipson and he asked, can you please tell me, he was a small boy, it must be quite scary for him to go to a British guy and ask him something like that. But the BNHS were very kind to him and they showed him a lots of these sparrows and said, this is different, it's a yellow-throated sparrow. And this was what excited this young boy very much, a schoolboy. And he eventually became India's greatest ornithologist and probably certainly the greatest conservationist we've ever had. The other picture you see there is on your right. It shows you the first job Salim Ali had. He became the nature educator for the first time in the Bombay Natural History Society. And here you see him doing something very interesting. He is actually taking blind schoolboys to the Prince of Wales Museum and making them feel all the different animals to say what they looked like. Now, this is very modern concept in terms of what he was doing. And this was early 1930s, where he was already starting to make nature trails and all for school children. This is his vision. So what exactly happened in that period was immense exploitation of forests because of the two world wars. And therefore, we lost a lot of animals during that period. Next, please. So what was happening in post-independence, early post-independence India? In the 1950s, just after independence, you see a lot of people talking about conserving wildlife. And interestingly, both Jawaharlal Nehru and Indira Gandhi were interested in conservation. They felt they were part of an elitist group of people who were doing this across the country. And so they began to support these movements. In 1951, again, the BNHS plays a very important role. We have a Bombay Wild Animals and Wild Birds Protection Act. This was spearheaded by a person called Humayun Abdul Ali. Humayun Bhai was a very interesting guy, really. He was, in fact, Salim Ali's cousin. And he worked in the BNHS as a bird taxonomist for a long time. But he learned a bit about law. And so he wrote the first act, which helped the Bombay presidency at that time to create something which would preserve wildlife. In 1953, India sets up a board for wildlife, which is a very interesting movement because during that period of time, no other country had something like this. So again, we are ahead of time. We are before most other countries had this interest. In 1960s, we have a new thing happening now. A lot of habitat loss, a lot of forest loss, a lot of drainage of wetlands and so on, and a lot of species lost. But I want to point out one thing. During this period of time and right up to now, India has not lost so many glamour species, so many large species. What we've probably lost is species that we know nothing about amphibia and about some reptiles and some insects somewhere, and about medicinal plants that we have lost and so on. We don't know enough about this kind of taxa. But I'll come to this later. We lost only one or two major mammal species and one bird. So this is something which is very interesting. With all the pressures that our country has of population, of deforestation, of whatever, major species we have managed to save. And I think that is a huge feather in the cap of India and our forest department and the government. So though you hear in the newspaper that, oh, it's so bad and we have lost so much, and when you actually come down to the brass scientific tacks, we haven't lost too much. What you see on your left there is Salim Ali and his first student, Dr. Ambedkar. He was from Pune. In fact, this picture is photographed just outside my house on Bun Garden Road when I was a schoolboy. The house that you see at the back is my home. And that is Salim Ali Ambedkar. Looking at a buyer's colony, the field next to my house on Bun Garden Road. So that is what we had in those days. There were little patches of grassland, little patches of thorn forest, and of course, lots of patches of agricultural land, bang inside Pune city. So since you are talking about Pune city so much, this is what we had. Coming to the 1970s, we amend our Wildlife Protection Act to make it much, much stronger. And in 1980s, we now believe that apart from saving species and saving habitats, we will also have to look at our genetic resources. This is a very, very important milestone in conservation, because if we are losing species of cultivars and livestock breeds, I think they're going to get enormous pressures in later times as climate change increases. So this was something that was happening in the 1980s. By 1986, you start all this being clumped with the word biological diversity. And so we have a National Biodiversity Strategy and Action Plan, which all came out of the 1990s UNCED or Rio Conference. At the Rio Conference, many countries decided that they should have a sort of convention on preserving biological diversity. And this became what we now refer to as the CBD, or Convention on Biological Diversity. And it had a various number of statutes within it that independent states, independent countries had to do for conservation. And therefore, it took us 10 years to do that. In 2002, we created, for the first time, a Biological Diversity Act. And I must tell you this, I have studied Biological Diversity Acts of many countries, and I find that ours is far more advanced than any other country that has created a Biological Diversity Act. So this is something that we actually need to understand. Now, what were the trends that we had to support nature conservation? And that very often came out of our research. And in the earlier period, we had three major sources of conservation research being done outside government conservation action takes. One was, we had mammal and bird surveys that way back in the 1930s. We already knew about this. We had large ecological projects being done between 70s and 80s. These were landmarks in international conservation. For example, the BNHS had a Bharatpur wetland project. It had 100 scientists, right? It had a bird ringing and migration project, which was a leader in migration studies. We had a grassland ecological project, and the key species in this was the Great Indian Bustard, which hasn't done so well, of course. But we also had something very different from many other countries. We had a lot of publications from the BNHS as field guides for birds, for mammals, for insects, for butterflies, amphibia, reptiles. These were things that began to interest people across the board, but invariably they were urbanites, they were English speaking, and therefore the rural sector never got the benefit of this. And that was a very, very sad thing that we didn't do this. But there were other organizations as well, WWF. WWF in the 70s and 80s had the largest nature conservation movement in the world. It had nature clubs for school children across the country. And there were hundreds of children were in these small nature clubs from school level. They also set up something which is referred to as the Indira Gandhi Conservation Monitoring Center, which did the first satellite imaging, the first GIS, and so on. And then we come to the government-supported Wildlife Institute of India. Again, a big, big time first, because this was generating activities which no other country was doing. Of course, the early research was on species, later on ecosystems, and much more recently, after the 1980s, much more on tiger-centric research. So this is what happened in terms of understanding what was happening. Now, what was happening in government, right? Let's look at the next slide. The current strategies that we have are really tiger-centric, actually. We have the National Tiger Conservation Authority now in the Ministry of Environment and Forest, which really looks at tiger conservation from a very scientific perspective. And this is really great because, again, we are, I think, when you compare with US and other countries also, we are very tech savvy. We have done things here which they have not yet done. We look at what they did for strategies, and you find government has set up a National Biodiversity Strategy and Action Plan, a very detailed document. And because we have this Biodiversity Act after 2002, we set up what is known as the National Biodiversity Authority in Chennai. What the National Biodiversity Authority is supposed to do is look after what the Biodiversity Act tells government to do. And therefore, we have local biodiversity management committees, and we create biodiversity registers. And this is something that we are now starting to do at the very local level. But there are many new things which are coming out in conservation, which I think you should actually, everybody should know a little bit about. That we've had, well, we'll come to that later. We have a large number of national parks and sanctuaries, but do they cover everything that we want to look after? Because there is a lot of biodiversity and wildlife outside national parks and sanctuaries. So now the international community has thought of creating other effective area-based conservation measures, which means small sites, community-conserved areas, and so on. And therefore, we now realize that all this is not going to be possible unless we are able to involve local communities from across the country. Now, this is very important. And therefore, if you look at this, we now have a strategy which is called Communication, Education, and Public Awareness. And so we have SDGs, as you know, where we talk about saving water, aquatic species, and saving terrestrial species. And we have IT targets, which are, the first IT target is CEPA, of Communication, Education, Public Awareness. We also have a Convention on International Trade of Endangered Species and a Wildlife Crime Control Bureau. So this is what we have done. Now, next slide. Let's look at what we did for botany. In a historical perspective, we documented flora and fauna through the art of the Mughals, but the British and Portuguese documented a huge number of flora. And we had this banker in Edinburgh, doctors who came and did all this botanical exploration in India. And on the basis of this, the East India Company developed what is now referred to as Kew Gardens, or one of the best floral collections in India. Next, please.
Mughal was the first flora of British India. And he assisted actually later on in 1890s in setting up the Botanical Survey of India and Calcutta Garden. And there were at that time actually battles on the Ganges Delta between different European nations, and they all got involved in that as well. So from this plant taxonomy of the early 1900s, we get a big jump in the 1920s, 30s to what William Roxburgh and Robert White wrote. So they did enormous surveys across India and way up into the Himalayas where no Britishers had gone. Many of these were doctors in fact. And then in the later 1900s, you find that there was for example, Father E. Blatter, who was from St. Xavier's College, and he developed an extensive herbarium western garden. So this was the early botanical part of basically what happened at taxonomy. They did not do enough ecological work. The first person to really set up ecological work was Dr. Salim Ali. Sir Salim Ali's bird surveys were the first thing that happened. And if you see that picture on the left side, this is the survey of Bastar. And you can see how they had to take this old jeep-like Kamali describes this in his life story, and he says that very often they used to get stuck in a pod like that, and they would call a bullock cart, and the bullock cart would pull them out. And if, he says, the bullock cart broke its axle in the process, then they would call some farmers who would go into the forest, cut a log, and make it into the axle for the bullock cart. So you can imagine how these surveys were done across the country. The next stage of what he did was getting into ecological projects for the first time. And the picture that you see on the right is Salim Ali in a boat doing bird rigging. They used to put up nets. Local people who were actually trappers knew how to do this. And Salim Ali would then take the bird out, and his team would put rings on them, and they would get the thing. Then the third type of thing that they did was bird migration study. And so very early, we were already from VNHS doing bird migration, coming from all the way from Siberia and so on. But you didn't know exactly the routes they were coming by and how they were coming through the Himalaya. So we had a limitation at that time on understanding what came out of these bird breeds. So this was all that we did in terms of botany and zoology and ornithology and so on, which strengthened the conservation movement up to the 1970s and 80s. But around this period of time, we started looking at habitats. And so we decided that apart from the shooting reserve that we had, we should plan our protected area network. And so in 1980s, we realized that what we have as protected areas are in fact the old Maharaja shooting reserves. And that's interesting. They were doing this for themselves, but when independence came, their areas were taken away, and they were reasonably well protected already, so they had good habitat. Okay? So here we started developing our own national parks and sanctuaries. By the 1980s, we realized that this was not going to work, that you needed a good representation of national parks and sanctuaries in different areas of India. And so we realized that if we wanted 5% of the area as national parks and sanctuaries, we would have to find a better way of doing this. And therefore, there were two scientists in Wildlife Institute. One was W.A. Rogers, if you can see him on that slide. And the other was Pawarsam, who was then the director of Wildlife Institute. Both these guys were tremendous scientists. They were wonderful teachers. And, I mean, I was taught everything by Aaron Rogers. So these two guys decided that they needed to find a new classification for this. And so for conservation, they made what are called biogeographic zones. And the map you see of Rogers and Pawar was created in 1988 with these 10 biogeographic zones. Now, at that time, they realized that they needed more national park sanctuaries in areas where the biodiversity was very high. And so what they did was, they found that Northeast India, Western Ghats, and Andaman Nicobar Islands, and most of the Himalayas required more protection than most other parts of India. So this is what happened in 1988. And what we do today in protection of conservation in India is still based on what Rogers and Pawar did. Next, please. So the sanctuaries and national parks are practically not even a dozen at attendance. Rarely by 1970s, we had about 65 national parks and sanctuaries. And today, I will ask you all, and I wish I could hear you to give me a reply, to say how many do you think there are now? We have more than 900 and some 90 or so protected areas in the country. Now, if you look at this graph, there are two times where around the 1986 to 1990, there is a big jump. That big jump is representative of suddenly adding 100 islands in our protected area network on the Nicobar Islands. So that's a bit of a response. So this happens. And then there is a gradual rise. But what is important to understand is that the majority of these were written up in 1988. That Rogers and Pawar had said that these are your potential areas where more national parks and sanctuaries have to be done.
and created and managed effectively. And so we had a management effective evaluation set up for national parks and sanctuaries following the 1990s. So this is it that we have done. Now, next please. I hope I'm not running out of time. Purnima?
Doc, you have 15, 20 minutes because we lost. So.
Okay. Now, a couple of things that we must really understand, and that was which were the institutions that did the conservation and which were the NGOs that did this. Today we had a large number of them, but the early ones were what you see here, which is the Bombay Natural History Society, which is at Lions Gate in Fort Bombay. There is WWF India in New Delhi, which has done a lot of work on conservation. And very and of course my own small little institute, which is the Bharti Vidyapeeth Institute of Environment Education in Pune. But there are many organizations which also created awareness for wildlife, and I think this is the most important thing that India has done. And that is they created a CPR Environment Education Center in Chennai, they created Center for Environment Education in Ahmedabad, and much later the BNHS led to formation of an organization called SACON in Coimbatore. These are NGOs or quasi-government organizations which have actually led to conservation and were leaders in conservation across our country and supported government in trying to make conservation happen. Next, please. Let's look a little briefly at, you cannot do conservation without good research. And many people don't realize this. Conservation has to be based, I believe I'm very passionate about conservation, as you started by saying, but I believe that the conservation cannot be done without good modern research. And that is the research which is the basis for conservation to happen. Now, as I told you, we haven't lost many big species because we very soon got into conservation based on good research. But we did lose some species. We lost the cheetah. The cheetah was lost because of hunting, but also because cheetah itself was a homozygous species. It had genetic problems in staying alive and keeping that species going. But there was a bird called the pink-headed duck that you see in that first picture, which is gone probably. Nobody's seen it for many, many years. And very unfortunately, we lost the Siberian crane from India. Now the Siberian crane used to come from Siberia to Bharatpur and go from Siberia into China. So there were two groups. So the Chinese one has survived, but it's gone somewhere around 2002, where these last three birds that I photographed and then they were gone. The other thing is, which are the species that are fairly well researched and therefore preserved now. And one is the tiger, Project Tiger, and the other is Project Elephant, which has led to elephant conservation and actually apprehending people who used to take elephants for ivory. But the saddest case is of our six species of vulture, which died very, very rapidly in hundreds because of one drug called diclofenac, which was used by veterinary doctors for cattle which were in batch. And this led to nephrotoxicity, kidney toxicity in vultures, and hundreds of vultures died till we've nearly lost this very important species. We also have some species which we are very badly neglected. We haven't got good work done on wolf, on wildlife. We haven't got good work on colony nesters of birds, very, very important. So we know little about certain insect species, amphibia, marine organizations. Only very recently we have started doing work more on marine organisms. And we know very little about certain rare endangered and threatened plants, especially of the Himalayas. So this is where our species now, research has to be shifted more into this kind of ecological and conservation research type of activities. Next, please. So how did this species conservation work? If you look at it, you find certain species were protected by certain individuals. For example, the Asiatic lion, which was left only in the Gir, and mind you, we talked about Jahangir and Shahjahan, they were shooting lions up the outskirts of Delhi. And finally, by the time we got independence, these were only present in one sanctuary in the Gir. And, you know, having any species which is in a single protected area is really dangerous. Because if you can get a disease, you can wipe it out. So, here you have the Maharajas of Junagadh, the rulers of Junagadh, I should say, who protected the lions and didn't even allow the viceroy to come and shoot back. So, you can imagine this is something very early. Then we come to BNHS and Wildlife Trust of India, looking after elephants and having some very great rulers. One was J.C. Daniel, who was the second BNHS, and A.D.K. John Singh, who worked with the Wildlife Institute of India. Even happened in the recent 30 years ago, you had suddenly a loss of tigers from Sariska and from Padna, and therefore government set up what is known as the National Tiger Conservation Authority. And it has done very good work, very good research through the Wildlife Institute. The animal tiger that you see, which I photographed there, is in Bandhavgarh, and he's got a radio collar, and he has been followed for many, many years. But and one of the great researchers in this was Asad Ramani of the PNHS, who tried to say, what do we do about grassland habitats and the great Indian bustard? Unfortunately, Maharashtra, Karnataka, about 7-8 years ago, lost all its bustard in grassland areas. And what they are left with is in Rajasthan. But 3-4 years back, we started what is known as an ex situ conservation research program, where we started breeding bustards, and it has been extremely successful. We are very lucky with this, right? Next. What else do we need to know for conservation? We need to understand how to do ecosystem research projects. And originally, they were mostly done for forests and a little later for grasslands, as I mentioned, and wetlands. But we had very little work done in Northeast, very little in Andaman Nicobars, also quite a not so great in coasts and coral reefs. Coral reefs, we didn't have anything till recently. And there's desert and marine species. So these are the habitats which we now need to look at much more intensively for a comprehensive conservation project program. Now in the next please. Now in the recent past, we have realized that you need communities to conserve forests, and the best, and also habitats of different types. If the local community does not want it, conservation will not happen. And therefore, we have to win over local people in trying to conserve various species and habitats. The Northeast, they were traditional hunter-gatherers, but they have now led many, many conservation movements. The picture that you see on your right side is a community conserved area in a small village called Jaluki, which has done excellent work over the last 10 years, right? The picture you see on the left side is very different. It's a community conserved area based on its sacredness. This is a Devrai in Mulshi Taluka. And you see the habitat there. It's incredibly different from anywhere else. You can see that these are very ancient forests, and communities have preserved them because of their religious sentiment for this. The next slide. The next aspect is preventing poaching. And preventing poaching is done by the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species, and now recently the Wildlife Crime Control Bureau. Now, what was being poached? Tigers were not poached necessarily for their skin, they were poached for bone, for their bone, as a medicinal value in China, Taiwan, and so on. Right? Elephants were, of course, poached for ivory, which had huge value in Japan and even in Europe. And sandalwood was another big poaching thing. Now, this was all done by a mafia-like thing. That mafia is nearly as big as the mafia for drugs, but it's hidden, completely hidden. But there's also this problem of poaching by local people. And unless we give them some alternatives, they are not likely to help us with conservation. So the pictures that you see there, the top picture on the left side, you can see a round thing at the where this lady is sitting. That's a tiger trap. And of course, there are all these different methods by which local people still trap. And we need to understand that these are very poor people. They need these resources. So unless you give them some alternative to this, that skin of the Russell's River that you see tied up there has got huge value in terms of illegal trade. So I think we need to understand this and give them an alternative so that poaching becomes less. Next, please. I mentioned to you earlier that I was taught a lot about conservation from this person called W.A. Rogers, Alan Rogers. And Alan always told us that you don't do conservation of wildlife. You do management of people. And that management of people is what leads to conservation. And this was so correct. Over the years, I've realized how correct he was. And there are several issues in this which we as people interested in conservation should understand. You don't want tigers and lions and elephants walking around your house, right? It's just not feasible. And therefore, we have this situation which we refer to as NIMBY, N-I-N-B-Y, not in my backyard. So it's okay if you have all this in the forest, in the protected areas, and if they go and damage people's crops, that never bothered about it. But this is what we're sure about. How do we get people's interest in conservation around protected areas if we want to actually do conservation? And this is perhaps the biggest thing that we want to do. And one way of doing that is what is now referred to as eco-develop. You develop the village to give them alternative sources, and therefore you compensate if somebody or she is eaten. You compensate for that, right? And if you compensate for that, they will get involved in conservation as well. And my experience with tribal especially has been wonderful. They really understand wildlife so much better than we do. And we think they're in good science, but these people have tremendous innate knowledge of wildlife, of its conservation methods, and also about trapping and so on. So what are the emerging technologies, please, that we need to understand in terms of conservation, right? We have a whole lot of things. The picture that you see there is a camera trap, right? Which can photograph an animal automatically as it passes by at night, and you have your knowledge of where these animals are going. But we need to do very many different types of studies now. We need to have behavioral ecology. How is the animal behavior changing in various ways? For example, due to tourism, which has hardly been explored, about habitat analysis. What are the best ways of creating habitats which have been degraded and bringing them back through an eco-restoration process? We need to look at what is going to happen with climate change. This is very, very scary. And unless we understand the effect of climate change on different habitats and different species, we are going to lose species much faster than we've ever lost them before. So one thing I'd like to say is that take research itself does not save species or habitats. It is a political will and advocacy from people like us who today have come to hear this talk, which will lead to better conservation. And there are many examples of how this has happened. Next, please. If you look at modern technology of satellite imaging, for instance, or of how you can put a radio collar and follow an animal or a bird all the way to Africa and back, for example, or you do DNA mapping for species to understand the genetic diversity that is there and how the genetics is behaving. If you take satellite images like you see there, and you can see actually changes happening in the forest habitat into an agricultural area, perhaps even into urban setups. So these are the examples of modern technology that we can use in terms of mission today, which we never had in the past. But basically, it's about how you feel about conservation, how much you love your wildlife, your wetlands, and your wetlands, your seacoast, which actually finally lead to advocacy, which government will listen to, and able to bring about better conservation measures. So thank you very much for being here, and I'm so sorry for this network. That's what happens with failing technologies. Thank you, Purnima.
Thank you, Doc.
Thank you. There are a few questions and comments in chat.